Good evening. I'm glad to be back here after Pesach. Thank you. Yesterday, I started the lectures in Brooklyn, and I made an announcement about the new CDs that we made. Baruch Hashem, we have three new collections in English, number 5, 6, and 7. So we used to have 1, 2, 3, 4. Now we have 5, 6, 7, full of lecture, 30 hours of lectures approximately. Plus, we have the Path to the Just and the Pirkei Avot. So it's 9 CDs. It's 270 hours of lectures, Baruch Hashem, plenty of time. And then we have the Hebrew also new collection, number 3 and 4. We're progressing, Baruch Hashem. So we're almost up to date. Some lectures cannot be put on a CD because it's long series, like the Talmud series or the 613 series. It's many, many lectures. We will have to do 4 or 5 CDs on to each person. It's already a problem. But we also have a new app on the website, which is great. You can get all the lectures for free on your app, on your iPhone and Android. Just hooked into the website, download it. And you can listen to all the lectures on your phone while you're in a car, excuse me, and anywhere else. We just read Parashat Shmini, and we found that the two brothers of Aaron just passed away. There's few opinions in Chazal exactly what they did, but not many of us paid attention how they died. You know, today we have a laser. What's a laser? You can have a laser gun. It sends fire. It can heat up anything. And it points in a point, like a microwave or things like this. It sends like a very thin line of fire. And it can burn many things. That's exactly what happened to them. It's the first time in the creation that laser was used. Two lines, Rashi writes, two lines of fire, two thin lines of fire came from heaven, right into their noses and burned them out from inside. If you know, you put food in a microwave, it begins to cook it from the inside out. Did you know? It's not like a fire. Fire always cooks from the outside. And then the longer it's on the fire, it's penetrating in until it reaches the center. The microwave, it sends it into the center, and it starts from inside out. Very interesting. So sometimes if you cut it, it will be harder inside and colder outside. That's what happened to them. One of the opinions in Chazal is, Oru alacha bifnei rabam, that the Moshe and Aaron were the chief rabbis of Israel, and the two sons of Aaron, even though technically they were even just as good or even greater than them, Nadav and Avihu, because the two chief rabbis were in the present, and they answer a question of law in front of the rabbis, that was enough already for them to lose their life. What can we learn from this? I always say the stories of the Torah doesn't come just to tell us history. It's not the purpose why the Torah was given. If Hashem wanted to teach us the 613 laws, he would give a Torah with 30 pages. Very thin. Doesn't need all the story, all the wars, who gave birth to who. Who cares? Just give and tell me a list, book of list. This is what you have to do. This is the Torah that God gave in Sinai. You have to keep A, B, C, D, all the way to 613. Finished. I have to tell me stories, that, how they build, all kinds of things that look not relative so much. Some of the things, for instance, instructions how to build the temple. That's a law. He could have written it in a law. You have to make the menorah, this is how you make it. So it can be a very long halacha. It can be the entire page. No problem. It's still one provision in a book of law. Some provisions could be 1 or 2 lines. Some could be 20 lines. It's no problem. It still be in the right order. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Finish the entire book of instruction. Thank you very much. You listen to me, you go to heaven. You don't listen to me, you go to hell. Thank you very much. See you then. That's it. Torah didn't need to be so complicated. What's all the stories, this war, the Moshe's hands were up, they were winning. When they were down, they were losing. Then prostitution, Amalek, epidemics. All these stories, what for? If you say God wanted us to also know history, by the way, while teaching us the law, that's a problem. Why? No nation needed God to give them their history. They can be responsible for history their own. Anyway, the Greeks know their history. The Arab knows their history. Every nation knows their history. Go to any of the Chinese, well, they don't know their history. They can tell you what happened 1,000 years ago. They have books of history. Transfer from generation to generation. So we could have made our own history book from the time of Moshe. We write, there was the war. We went to war, we won against Amalek, we killed them, they killed us, whatever the story was. And that could be. And that's it. It would be a separate book. The fact that it became an integral part of the divine book of the creator of the world, it shows us that every word is halacha. Every word in the Torah is a book of law. It just brought into the book in a way of a story. But every story comes to teach something for generations. What do we learn from this story? That the two sons of Aaron went into the Mishkan to serve Hashem. One opinion, they were drunk a little bit. Not like the drunk people in the club. You know, they don't know what their name is. A little bit, they drank a little wine. So that's already forbidden. God said to Aaron right after that, the Kohanim cannot drink any alcohol before they go, any wine. One opinion, because they taught in front of Moshe and Aaron. You know, so it's very interesting. All these opinions that I brought up, Chazal bringing, it could be that one of them, that's really what happened, could be all of them correct. We don't know. We will know when Mashiach comes exactly what happened there. We know there's few opinions in Chazal. Most of the time, it's all of them together. It could be this and this and that, all combined. Well, we don't know. One thing for sure we know, that when you come and teach halacha in front of the rabbi, it's a very severe sin. But now you ask me, okay, wait a minute. I was one time in a shul, and the rabbi was there. And somebody asked, how do you wash your hands? Some chiloni came, secular Jew, first time in his life, he washed his hand for bread. So he asked one of the people in the table, how do I make netila? The rabbi was there. So he told him, you have to first do the right hand, then the left hand. So now he has to die? Because he told him how to wash his hands? This is what God is about? What do you think? Or somebody asked, what bracha I make on this cookie? So some person told him, mezonot. One person said, no, it's shakol. It's from rice flour. It's not really wheat. He told him, what is it from? So he told him the halacha. So now he has to die? So obviously, that's not what it means. That simple, ordinary halachot that every little kid knows or every ordinary person knows. This you can teach in front of the rabbi, even if he's there. It's no problem. It's public halachot. We are talking, there are two parts of halacha in life. There is the ordinary halachot that everyone must learn and know by heart to be able to know how to behave every day from the minute you wake up. What you say, the first sentence of the day, how you wash your hands, how you get dressed, how you put your shoes on, all these little things that looks very little and not so important, they have importance in them. Nothing is coincidence. It's not a culture. It's not a cultural thing. Why you have to put this shoe first and the other one, or this hand first, and why you cannot touch your eyes before you wash your hands. All these things, it's not a cultural thing. Some of them are critical. That's how important they are. You know how many sicknesses are in the world that people don't wash their hands when they get up in the morning? Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul, the biggest Kabbalist in the world, told my cousin, which was his student for many years, he told him if the secular Jews would know how many sicknesses they get in their life for not washing their hands in the morning, not one of them will miss a netilah one day in his life. Secular, behave like goyim. They'll wash their hands right away. Going into the cemetery, you have to wash your hands. Jewish cemetery, non-Jewish cemetery. What happens if a tree comes from the cemetery to the street? It's like a tent. The impurity of the graves, does it come to the street? No, what happens if there's a wall? All kinds of questions. It's millions of questions in life. Millions. Literally millions of questions, maybe more. Not all of them appear in a book of law. The book of law only teach you how to do from A to Z in a normal, ordinary way of life. Every day, and a holiday, and Shabbat, then tzitzit, then tefillin, how to make the tefillin, how to make the tzitzit, what's kosher, what's not kosher, who should make it, then circumcision, everybody must know it. So it all appears in the book of law. They didn't forget anything. However, in life, there are always new situations. One day they invented microwave. It's not in the book of law. In the time of Moshe Rabbeinu, there's no microwave. And in 500 years ago, when the Shulchan Aruch was written, there was no electric. You know how many thousands of laws needs to be translated to the people according to today's generation to know what to do? Electric, Shabbat, Yom Tov, to put it on, off. We're allowed to tell a goy to do it for us. We're not allowed. When yes, when no. Sick person, what kind of sickness? You know how many thousands of laws just about the light on Shabbat? Timer, kosher, not kosher. Which timer is kosher? Which one is not? You're allowed to extend the time? Let's see, you forgot. You forgot to say that. And now you have more guests coming, and the light is about to go off any minute. You're allowed to extend it by moving the clip. I'm not touching the light. I'm just moving the clip, and the clip will do the job. Can I do it? There's a difference between Shabbat and Yom. You know how many laws like this you have? So Baruch Hashem, today, thousands of books are printed every year all over the world, and they're speaking about more and more unique and new scenarios, like elevator. One day an elevator was invented. You're allowed to use it. What happened if there's weight in the elevator? It makes sparks in the engine. So by me going in, the elevator is capable of taking four people comfortably. Now I'll be the fifth one, then it's put already too much pressure on the engine. It's like the cars in Israel, when you rent a car, in Israel all the cars is like little motorcycles. They have little engine, you know. So if it's only you, the car will go up to Jerusalem. If it's you and a friend, already the car is, you know, really struggling. And if it's hot, you put the air conditioner on, that's it. This little tiny scooter becomes a big semi-trailer. You know how these big trucks, they try to go on a mountain and everyone goes crazy? That's how it is. So what happened in the elevator? If you went in, now it's going to make sparks in the engine. Sparks coming out, so I'm creating fire on Shabbat. The Torah say you should not create any fire on Shabbat. And the written Torah did not specify in what way not to create fire. The written Torah. That's where the oral Torah comes in, which I always say probably thousands of times by now, until people will finally get it. The written Torah, it's worthless without the oral Torah. Completely worthless. Doesn't have even 1% value. Nothing. It's nothing, just a piece of paper. That's what the goyim don't understand. They have millions of questions about the Torah. Because they don't understand our Torah, it's not like your books. Your books is one piece of a document. It's whatever somebody wrote there, that's all you have. By us, the written Torah is only 1% of Judaism. Not even. All Judaism comes from the oral Torah. All the laws is oral Torah. All the traditions, oral Torah. All the customs, oral Torah. All the secrets, oral Torah. All the Kabbalah, oral Torah. Almost nothing written Torah. I once said, if God forbid, the goyim would come, like the time they used to do in Germany, making pogroms, and they come and say, okay, we have to burn one of your Torahs. And we got to dismiss it. For good, God forbid. The written or the oral? Which one are you giving up? We have no choice. You don't give up, they'll take both of them. We have to give them one. Which one will I have to let them take? The written. Give them the written Torah? Yeah, we'll stay with the Shulchan Aruch and the Talmud. It's more critical. Because the bottom line, what does Hashem care? That you know the entire written Torah by heart? Or that you're going to behave according to the laws? What really he cares about? If you have two Jews, one knows the entire Torah by heart, a genius. Photographic memory can tell you the whole Torah, like the Gaon Mivilna wrote the Torah in reverse. 304,805 letters. So somebody like that, he knows everything by heart, but he doesn't keep one law. Or someone who doesn't know anything, his memory is messed up completely, but he keeps all the laws. He grew up like a robot. His father taught him what to do. He keeps everything. Ask him to tell a Dvar Torah about Parashat HaShavua. He doesn't know who was the son of Esav. He doesn't know who was the son of Yaakov. He doesn't remember the 12 tribes. He doesn't remember the 10 commandments by heart. He doesn't know, you know, the story of Cain and Hevel. He doesn't know the exodus of Egypt. There's many things he doesn't know. But he keeps all the laws. Two Jews. One knows everything, keeps nothing. One don't know nothing, keeps everything. Who's better?
Nothing.
The one who keeps the law. That's the bottom line. You keep or you don't keep. That's how we're going to be judged. A part of the law, by the way, at least one of the 613 mitzvot, is that you must be knowledgeable in Torah. So over here, automatically you have a problem. You don't know Torah if you're ignorant. We're not talking that your mind is black, that you're born with a very, very bad brain. Memory doesn't work. You cannot focus. You cannot... That's what we call in English stupid. If you're born very stupid, and you're stupid in everything you do in your life, not only in Torah, everything. In math, you're stupid. In history, you're stupid. In business, you're stupid. In medicine, you're stupid. The doctor tells you to take three times, one spoon, three times a day. You go home, you take 30 times a day. Everything by you is messed up. And you also don't know Torah. Okay, you're dismissed. Shote patur mitzvot. There's a halacha. Shote in Hebrew, there's two kinds of shote. There's two kinds of mita, two kinds of shote. Shote, it's shin, vav, tet, hey, and also shin, vav, taf, hey. Two different meanings. Shote with taf, it's someone who drinks. Shote is drinking. Shote with tet is a fool. To teach you that when you drink too much, you become a fool. But that's besides the point. But then you have, there's a joke on Shabbat. האוכל חמין בשבת חייב מיטה. Someone who eats chulent on Shabbos, חייב מיטה. What's חייב מיטה means in the language of Chazal? חייב מיטה, מיטה with taf, it's death. Has to be executed, God forbid. Also, חייב מיטה with tet, it means he needs a bed to sleep because the stomach is very heavy. After he eats it, it's so heavy in his stomach, right away everyone falls asleep. I wish I can take pictures of my guests on Shabbat after they finish the meal. They all sit on the couch. 3 minutes later, four or five guys, whatever, see, everyone is already snoring, right? So heavy, the meal of the Shabbat morning. One of the greatest achievements, if after you ate it, you're still able to sit 3-4 hours and learn. That's really like already a great achievement. Because most of the people, 5-10 minutes later, they already sleep. So, all this book of laws, God could have made it 1, 2, 3, and that's it. But he put stories inside to teach us. From the stories, we learn a lot. For instance, the Torah tells us that the son of Aaron made God angry. And they left, they die young. And also, they never got married. One more reason that God was angry at them. We don't know the whole story. We only know what we need to know. And everything we know from the oral Torah. Without it, we wouldn't know. One of the reasons that God was very angry at them, they did not want to get married. They held in their mind that the Jewish girls in those times were not good enough for them. We are, you know, way above average. There's no girl is worthy of marrying me. That's it. It sounds like his nose is all the way up. No one to get married. The Ari HaKadosh say that Nadav, one of the two, I don't know the story of Avihu, I didn't find a source for it, but Nadav, one of the two sons, he came back in his next life as Samson the prophet. He came back in reincarnation. He would say Shimshon, Samson in Hebrew it's Shimshon, Badan. is from the tribe of Dan. Badan means in Dan. In Dan means in the tribe of Dan. Badan, Bet, Daled, Nun, if you mix the order of the letters, is Nadav. What was his end? That the Goya, the Philistine Goya, which was very beautiful, this Delilah destroyed him. He had strength. He was Nazir. In English, the word Nazir, it's a monk, but it's really not what Torah means, a monk. Means Nazir means he's holy from birth. Or he accepts later Nazirut, by not eating grapes, no wine, and not cutting his hair. So he was holy from birth, because the angel came to his mother. What was the name of his mother? It doesn't say in the Tanakh. But the Oral Torah is teaching us that her name was Tzlalfonit. Tzlalfonit. You don't find any Jewish woman in the world that this is her name, to the best of my knowledge. But that was her name. And her husband's name was Manoach. Manoach. And the Chazal, you don't find it in a parasha. But Chazal, our sages, teaching us that his father was an ignorant Jew. Wasn't a rabbi or anything like that. Manoach Amaretzaya, the Gemara says. And then the angel came to his wife, to his future mother. She's not pregnant yet. She's a barren. It's interesting. All the barren women gave birth to special people. And he said to her, next year you're going to have a baby. And it's going to be holy from birth and all that. And then when her husband came, he saw the man of God. He saw an angel. This is one of the sources that angel exists. A few places, like with Bilam, with his donkey. The donkey saw the angel. And then Bilam couldn't see it. Then he says that Hashem opened the eyes of the donkey, so the donkey saw the angel, but Bilam himself, which was a prophet of the Goyim, he couldn't see him. Only later he realized what's happening. But in the beginning he didn't see, he was hitting the donkey. Why don't you want to go? And later he saw there's an angel there. Also when Yoshua ben Nun, when they're getting ready to go to the war, an angel came to him with a big sword. We just read it in Haftarah. And he asked him, he said, for two reasons Hashem sent me. One of the reasons was that they didn't learn enough Torah. So he told him, which one was worse? He told him, not learning Torah, but he told Torah is the biggest sin. So the angel came. So we see a few dialogues in the Tanakh between a human being to an angel. It obviously exists. We also see in the Tanakh that we can call a spirit of a person who died and ask him questions about the future. Where do we see that the souls are somewhere and we just have to bring them back to this world? Shmuel, Samuel the prophet, and King Saul. King Saul is very afraid. Tomorrow is a big war and he feels that they're not strong enough. And he brought the spirit of Samuel the prophet and he told him, tomorrow you and your children are all going to die. And you come to where I am. And I once said, the bad news that they're all going to die tomorrow, the good news we can dream to be in the level of Samuel the prophet. So, Manoach, so the wife of Manoach, Tzlalfonit, she said to her husband, a holy angel, the man of God was here. So the Gemara say, how did she know that he's holy? The Gemara asked. How do you know if a person is holy? There's a way to look at a person and know if he's holy or not. You know how many people in Israel, they had a reputation of holy people, and one after the other become worse than Hitler? So, what happened in the end? 10, 15 years, they fooled the whole world. And in the end, Hashem exposed them to the world. I had a list. About a year ago, maybe a year and a half ago, I once gave a lecture about the fake babot. You remember this lecture? Most of you don't speak Hebrew. It was in Hebrew. It was a very controversial lecture in Israel. You don't hear the news. Over here, you see it, Queens, quiet. In Israel, there's a lot of problems. So why? Because a lot of these fakers knew that I jeopardized their status by waking up the fools who follow them to stop giving them millions and make their bank account fatter and fatter. So people started to think finally. Not everyone. Most people are still stay the same in their same stupidity. So when I gave that lecture, I had in mind a list of names. A list of names. I didn't want to say it in front of a camera. For the honest reason that I know that maybe a week later I won't be alive. Because a lot of them is mamash like gangster, like real mafia. They have all kinds of gangster around them, ex-criminals. They don't like you, they execute you. That's how it is. I'm not afraid to say the truth. They're full of violence. They send people and you do something against them, they make you understand that you don't mess with them. That's how horrible these people are. But they have beautiful beards, all fakers. So what happened is I had in mind a list of them. A list. Knowing all these crooks, what they do to people from over the years of hearing what happened to all these people. So 2 days after the lecture, only Hashem and I knows that I'm saying to you the truth. I can't prove my mind to you. You have to either believe me or not. It's up to you. But I know what I had in my mind when I gave this lecture. So when I had this lecture, I had two of them mainly. I had very strong in mind because it was fresh in my mind. Just heard stories about them constantly again and again and again. So one of them, 2 days later, somebody stuck a knife to his heart and killed him. Came, pretended he wants a bracha from him, took up a knife, stabbed him in his heart and killed him on the spot. That was the first one in the list. The second one, 2 weeks exactly later, the Israeli IRS caught him doing all kinds of things. From then until now, you don't hear a beep from him. He's up to here with problem, investigation, jail, police, problem. Cannot show his face. The third one, just a week ago, exposed to the world, raping married women every night. Married women every night. How long you can be a faker? 30 years, 20 years. Nobody thinks about the day that Hashem will decide to open the screen. The big chilul Hashem that will happen when they show you in the newspaper with your beautiful beard. And now all the people would open their eyes. First of all, you have to know, most people, unfortunately, they think with their heart, not with their brain. So if they have a person that they look up to, and this person collapsed, and they found him later as a faker, what happened to them? Instead of becoming more religious, that I won't end up like him, they leave their religion. I don't understand, what's the connection? Just because you saw a person that knows Torah, that was his end, you have to know how much more you have to be careful, not to end up like him. If your friend went into drugs and died, so you have to go into drugs and die also? The opposite. You have to stay away from it like fire, like an atomic bomb. Why? Because your friend died from it. And he was greater than you. He was more religious than you. And he died from drugs. Or for whatever happened to him. That should be a red light for you. How do I not end like him? There's still one thing that nobody can understand. I don't understand why these people need to make the sins that they do. There were ways to make sins in a much, much safer way for them, to avoid all this chilul Hashem. The Gemara gave an advice to a sinner that cannot control his desire how to make a sin, and hopefully one day God will forgive him. But at least the Gemara say, don't make a bad reputation to the religion because you will hurt thousands. Thousands of people will fall. Don't think only about your desire. What's going to happen to all these people? But they don't learn. They don't learn. They make the sin in their homes. Every day when people are right here from the other side of the door. And that's what's happened. So one of them now escaped from Israel. He's hiding in a country that there's no, that the Israeli government cannot put their hand on him. But the police is after him now. But the things that really boils my blood, I don't know, maybe we deserve it. I'll tell you the truth, sometimes a person really deserves the punishment. Stupidity hurts. I heard today that 100 of his Hasidim, his followers, are planning to take a flight and go be with him in Lag BaOmer. Instead of go kill him, they go to support him for raping married women. You understand what's happening here? This is what happened to the face of the religious people today. No direction, no learning. Everyone like shepherds without a, like sheep without a shepherd. Whatever happened. And nobody uses his head. And also it's called, it's something in psychology that called cognitive dissonance. You heard about this? So when the brain hears something, the heart also get the same information, the brain and heart. The brain catch right away, but sometimes may take 7 years to the heart until you finally digest what you just learned 7 years ago. That's what happened when Albert Einstein shocked the world with the theory that in the beginning was a theory and then became a scientific fact. And all the scientists of this generation, when they checked his results, they came to the same results. And they say, impossible. It cannot be we all lived in mistake for hundreds of years. They put it in the garbage. 7 years, nobody confirmed it. Not one of them had something to disprove what he said. But 7 years, there was not one person who signed, he's right, we were always wrong. Same thing Christianity. I know a few hundreds of Christians who left Christianity, and Baruch Hashem, they became righteous Gentile, and few of them also converted to Judaism. What about the millions, the extra million who watch the debate and stay what they are? How can it be? Are they blind? They have no brain? They don't see every page in this book is full of ridiculous human errors like children, like kindergarten? What happened? Remember what the priest say in the last sentence of his of the debate? My heart doesn't let me leave it. It was so good to me over the years. Illusion. Ah, like taking LSD. Drugs. Oh, life is beautiful. The heart. It's all an illusion. So I answer him. We're not here to talk about illusions here. We're talking facts, brains. I just proved to you it's not a divine book. What a person of the truth, what should he say right away? Maybe not in front of a camera, he's embarrassed for his reputation. 5 minutes after you shut the camera, mazal tov. Congratulations. You made the point clear. No more argument. You know, like in a court, the lawyer say, the defense rest. I'm giving up. You know, one guy was in the court and they're blaming him for murder. So just when the jury is already convinced all the evidence is against him, that's it. It's about another hour they sentence him to electric chair. So his lawyer was a brilliant Jew. And he said to the jury, ladies and gentlemen, in 10 minutes, the real murderer will walk into this courtroom through this door. And all of you will see how wrong you could have been sending him to death when the real murderer is out there. No, he's in the courtroom. The reporter, everyone prepare his camera. Phone calls. Breaking news. You know? Maybe they even announced in CNN. Breaking news from the courtroom in downtown Manhattan. What happened? After 10 minutes, the judge, everyone is waiting. No one walks in. So the lawyer said to the judge, you see, the law in the United States say that you can only convict a person if you have proof against him beyond a reasonable doubt. Now, don't you agree with me that all of you believed me that the murderer will come here in 10 minutes? You're all staring at the door. How can you sentence a person to death when you're thinking the real murderer is out there? See, you have a doubt. Huh? Good, no? So I was about to call mistrial. But one woman, she said, no. She convinced all the jury back to convict him, and that's what happened. So they asked her, why were not you were not convinced with the arguments that his lawyer made? So she said, when everyone was staring at the door, I stared in the eyes of the defendant. And I saw that he's the only person in a courtroom who did not look at the door. You know, the real murderer is sitting right here. If there was another murderer, he would be the first one who goes like this. Where is my salvation will arrive? Right? But he didn't look. His eyes were on the table. Because he knows. But in the end, that's what happened. Now we have a question here. So, in what law a student that teach in front of his rabbi deserve to die? Only something complicated, that it's not written in Shulchan Aruch, and you need a serious investigation. And we have thousands of questions like this every week, Baruch Hashem. Somebody sent a question to a big chacham, and a student is answering for the rabbi. If he asks permission, or the rabbi asks him, I don't have time, answer for me. It's a different story. He gave him permission. But even there's a question in this Passover night, when we have to sit and eat the matzah and drink the wine on the left side like kings, Heseva, if your rabbi is in the table, if you're allowed to do it in front of your rabbi. You're allowed to feel like a king when your rabbi is over there. Bottom line, to conclude, the Torah says, Et Hashem Elokecha Tira. Fear your God. In English, it's not translated good. Let me explain why. Because in Hebrew, it's a divine language. Every letter is teaching a lot. So the Torah says, Et Hashem Elokecha Tira. There was one rabbi, his name was Rav Shimon Amsoni. That was his name. I was teaching in the yeshiva. And he said, we have a rule. Every time the Torah said the word et, it comes to include someone else, that it's not mentioned in a verse. Like, for instance, Kabed et avicha ve'et imecha, respect your father and your mother. The Torah could have said, respect your parents. Or respect your father and mother. He didn't have to say, respect your father and your mother. Instead, like extra et, kabed et avicha ve et imecha. He say, kabed et avicha ve imecha. You don't need another et. So it comes to include your older brother. When the father is not around, who is in charge? The oldest son. Also to respect him. You owe him respect. But it doesn't say in the Torah. This is one of the oral laws. It's come lerabot, to include. So he says, every et in the Torah, he was teaching his students what it came to include. This, that, or they go one verse after the other. Every et in the Torah, he comes. You see, this et is to include this. This et is to include that. When they came to this verse, fear your God. Et Hashem Elokecha Tira. Fear your God. He got stuck. Because we have a rule. We should not be afraid of anyone besides Hashem. Even if we're afraid of other things, it's normal. Moshe was afraid from the snake. Hashem told him, throw your cane on the floor, and it will turn into a snake. And when he said the snake, he went back. So it's a natural reaction. It's no problem, it's natural. That's not what we're talking about. You're not allowed to be afraid. It's natural reaction. If there's bombs, these, planes, war, of course you get scared. Not something is not normal about you. Unless if you're such a big tzaddik, like they say the story about this rabbi in the Holocaust. Today in Israel was the Holocaust Day, which is also against the Torah to make a mourning day in the month of Nisan. Nisan, you're allowed not to do any mournings for anyone who died. All they had to do is to wait another week, and they could have done it. But the communists, which are anti-religion, every law they made, intentionally or not intentionally, somehow is against Judaism. You decide if it was intentional or not. But that's it. So that's why religious people don't celebrate, celebrate is the right word, do not participate in a Holocaust Day in Israel. They don't participate. And also when they make the siren in Israel, that's also a goyim custom. In Judaism, siren means nothing. The goyim invented to make a siren and everyone stand like this on the street for 1 minute. It's much better to say Kaddish for all the deceased people. It will help them a billion times better than standing like this in the street. But there's only one problem. The law is very stupid to stand like this. To make a siren is very stupid. The date that they chose is very bad. It's against Hashem, it's against the Torah, against Judaism. Although it's stupid and it's bad and it's a bad timing, there are religious people who are very, very not clever. When you see all the secular people stand on the street, why on purpose you walk in their face? What is it like? Like you see Christian people put crosses in a park, let's say, on the grass, and you walk and step over it. In front of their eyes. Yeah, it's an idol worshipping. Yeah, they have the image of JC on their crosses. It's make God very angry, all this idol worshipping. In front of their eyes, you come, you walk over it. Why to instigate a fight? Why to create hatred? Why? It's very stupid. So some of them, they walk. But today, something even much worse happened, perhaps for the first time in Israeli history, that some religious people went to the park in Jerusalem and made barbecue. So the chief Ashkenazi rabbi of Israel went so furious, he spoke about it in his speech. He said, who gave permission to be such a wicked person? The yarmulke, this was almost like a murderer. After all, yes, the custom is non-Jewish, and the timing is against the Torah. But after all, who are they crying for? For your own parents, for your own brothers and sisters, for the 6 million Jews that were murdered in the Holocaust. So after all, the cause, it's a positive cause. They're not doing something against the Torah. The timing, yes, but the actual memory of all the Jews that died in the Holocaust, they mean well. So why you get them angry? For what? That's stupid, stupidity. You don't agree with the Zionists? Fine. You hate communism because it's against Hashem? Fine. You hate the wicked people? Fine. So far you did not violate any rule from the Torah. To go and start a fight with them? It's not so simple. Even David HaMelech say, Mesanecha Hashem Esna. God, all your enemies are my enemies. I hate them. Is that a sin? No. If it was a sin, David HaMelech wouldn't write it, and it wouldn't be an integral part of the Tanakh. It means God agree with that. You love me, you have to hate the people who hate me. That's why I once made a lecture, if you remember, a few years ago. The title of the lecture was, is a good person, but he's not religious. That's a very common sentence. When you ask about someone, he's a great person, but he's not religious. There's no such thing. There's no such thing. If you thought another minute before you say this stupid comment, you wouldn't ever say it. If a person is good to the entire world, but he hates God, or he's against God, or he's ungrateful to God, there's no more despicable person than him. Because being nice to every person and on purpose to go against God makes you a worse human being, not a better human being. If you're bad to everyone, it just shows it's your nature. You're a nasty person. So God and other people, you hate the same way. You don't care about people. You don't care about God. You're still in their face. You're still in his face. The Gemara say, what's worse? A thief that's still in your face? Or a thief who's still behind your back? So everyone say, a thief that wait until you turn around and he's still behind your back. He's embarrassed from stealing, no? The Gemara said the opposite. The Gemara said, no, my friend. If he's still in your face, it's not as bad when he's still behind your back. Why, stealing in your face, showing you, I don't care about you, I don't care about God. You and God for me are nothing. Equal, nothing against nothing. Zero, zero. Stealing behind your back means I care about what you think. I'm afraid of you. I'm embarrassed from you. I don't feel comfortable stealing in your face. Still behind your back. But what about God who watched me? No, he's zero for me. You are 50, he's zero. So you make him better than God. He actually was. And nobody thinks like this. Without this Gemara, nobody would know it. Who would think about such an idea? That a person that hides when he steals is worse than a person that steals in your face. Right? That's the verse. Arur ha'oseh baseter. Arur is a very big curse. ארור העושה בסתר. So, they decided to make a barbecue today. They couldn't do it tomorrow. They had to do it today in the park. You understand what's happening? I have no doubt in my mind that the punishment that we'll get will be very serious. Even though technically by the book, they didn't violate any rule from the Torah. But to be decent, it sometimes involves with things that not necessarily written in the Torah. That's called Vasita Yashar Vatov, or it's called Lifni Mishurat Adin. The Gemara brings an example of one rabbi that his workers broke a barrel of wine for him. And the wine was handmade wine, not like today, $4 a bottle, as much as you want. Handmade with the feet like this, stepping, it's a big process, cutting everything manually done. It's a long thing. It's worth fortune, a barrel of wine. How do you know wine was really, really expensive, like gold? Because the Gemara compliment people who make Havdalah on wine, or they make Kiddush on wine, which means it was not so common. It's like a treasure. You know, to work so hard that you have a glass of wine for Kiddush, wasn't something. You go to the supermarket, food stamps, Uncle Sam sponsor your wine, and you come and it wasn't like that. There's no Uncle Sam. There was Uncle Shem, no Sam. Uncle Shem, Jews came from Sam. You don't love Jews, he's anti-Semite. So Uncle Shem, we always had, Baruch Hashem. But Uncle Sam did not have food stamps in those days. On China's expense. Uncle Sam print, and China pays the bill. You know how it goes, this whole world. If you really know what's happening in this world, you learn a little bit economy, you won't believe how hypocrite this world is. You know, United States give aid to almost every country in the world, even to their biggest enemies, this radical Islam, like Jordan, Egypt, all these countries, they give them aid. They also give aid to China, which mainly, if you really think about it, is the biggest enemy of the United States. And China is a wealthier country than the United States. They don't owe trillions. In China, you don't have a number that starts in Queens and finishes in Brooklyn on a board when you go. And it's changing by the minute. You see the numbers in Manhattan, how they change? Do you know every little move over there? It's another 5 buildings in Manhattan. Every second, 5 more buildings, 10 more buildings. That's what it goes. That's not another $10, $50, $100. It moves in millions. In millions, literally, every second. Yeah, one bad day in a stock market is like a few billion dollars lost in a matter of minutes sometimes. You know. One time they say on Sheldon Adelson, his stock, Las Vegas Sand, lost a few dollars. They say he lost, I don't remember how much it was, but such an amount that was enough to sponsor the entire country of Israel budget for the entire year. One Jew, what he lost that day. Then he made it back 10 times more. That's besides the point. Just to show you what's happening. But we, the ordinary people, we have to understand the conclusion of this whole talk, that the halakha that comes away from the Torah, it's not just black and white. There's a lot of arguments about halakhot. Sometimes you see two rabbis arguing, searching for the truth, and they're all using the same Torah. And sometimes there's contradiction. And for many of the stories of the Torah, we learn what to do, what not to do. And that's why those stories appear in the Torah. And that's why the Torah brought us the story of the two sons of Aaron. And also the Torah wanted to teach us about the level of Aaron, that his two sons, 2 out of 4, died in a second, and he did not make a beep. And he even blamed himself. Later, when he goes with Moshe into Ohel Moed, after Moshe telling him, make all the sacrifices, 7 days preparation to entering the Mishkan, and the Shekhinah did not come, the Spirit, the holiness of God did not come to Ohel Moed, that's where it's supposed to come. Aaron felt horrible because of the sin of the golden calf. even though Aaron was anus. You know what anus? It was forced. They already killed Hur, his nephew. Hur died because he refused to this wicked Erev Rav. Who made the golden calf? The Egyptian Goyim, who came out of Egypt. They came from Russia because they heard the Israeli government giving $15,000 to every Goy Amalek that came from Russia. All he has to do is to be 1 month in Israel. The government will give him $15,000, a car, half a price, help with an apartment. So they live a year or two in Israel, take the money, and then come to Queens. You understand? That's what happened. 800,000 of these Amalekim settled in Israel and destroying us from inside right now. The centers of Amalek, every corner, pork store, prostitution home. Do you know that almost there's no building in Israel that at least one of the big ones, that at least one of the apartments is not a prostitution home? Do you know what's happening there? You know what it means, 800,000 Goyim, that their culture is based on prostitution? That since 11 years old, the dream of the girls is to be a prostitute because her mother teaching her that's your way to freedom. Like in Thailand or in Russia, that they dream about finding a rich man. Let's be a prostitute that will take me and save me from this poverty and whatever. And now Israel is full of them. And they already have children. And soon they're going to have grandchildren. And nobody knows these grandchildren are Goyim from Zera Amalek. And if you're not ultra, ultra orthodox, that you're going to check few generations who is going to marry your grandchildren, what's happened? All your grandchildren will be Goyim, but not Goyim. Many Goyim are righteous. Still doesn't give us permission to marry them. To marry, it's a different story. Righteous Goyim, and they go to heaven, still don't have permission to marry them. We are not talking the righteous Goyim. We are talking Goyim from Zera Amalek. All the problems we have, indirectly or directly, depending how you want to see it, comes from Russia. Who supported the Arabs in the last 70 years against us? Who gives them all the weapon? Who protect Assad now from not collapsing? Who makes all the problem in the Middle East? All Russia. It's all Russia. United States is afraid of Russia. They wanted to go into Syria and put Assad out of commission. China and Russia gave them an ultimatum. Get your boat out of there before we go in. Very powerful. They have atomic bombs. They have very big army. Very powerful. And the Russians, when they go to war, I don't want to tell you what's going to happen. Afraid of them. They support all the terrorism. They help Iran. Thanks to them, Iran continues preparing an atomic bomb that is dedicated for you and I. For us, for who is they making? Iran making an atomic bomb to put it on the shelf in a museum? That's a dream. So who helps them? Who are all the scientists in Iran that create the nuclear place? It's all the science there in Russian. You saw the picture that they published? All the signs are in Russian. They build the bomb. They give them what they need. They give them the money. They send the engineer. In the wars against Israel, who do you think were the pilots who flew the MiGs? Russian pilots. You think the Arabs know how to fly a plane? They only know how to fly a plane in September 11 because Hashem flew those planes. Why? They went to learn how to fly. And they say, okay, tomorrow we begin to learn how to land. So all these Arabs who participated in the September 11 attack, they didn't come to learn how to land. They only learned how to take off. And it didn't raise a flag. One person wants to learn a few months how to be a pilot, and is not interested to learn how to land. Well, he's thinking, if I miss the twins, let's see, he didn't hit the twins. He came close to the building and he didn't. He was falling somewhere in Manhattan. So, what's the worst can happen? Instead of this famous building, we'll fall in a building in downtown or five other ones. Still make a horrible terrorism attack. With all the fuel and 300-400 people on a plane, there's going to be a massive attack one way or the other. Thousands will die. The idea was to hit the trade center. Fine. But if they miss it, what's going to happen? They fall somewhere. To fall, you don't need to be a genius. They didn't care. And nobody cared. None of the teachers in school thought to call the FBI. There's few Arabs here. that are not exactly known as Nobel Prize winners for the peace, except Arafat, which was a very, very Baruch Hashem tzaddik, and they gave him a prize winner together with Rabin, hugged, kissed. Arafat, the massive murderer, got the Nobel Prize winner. Yeah, that's where we live. Very depressing. אין לנו על מי לסמוך, אלא על אבינו שבשמיים. If we don't trust Hashem, we are finished. There's only one solution, that's it. You trust Hashem, whatever happened, happened. At least we know that if we go out of here, we left this world trusting Hashem. Then it's a ticket for life of eternity, one way or the other. You have to remember, 80% of the Jews didn't come out of Egypt for one problem. One. They didn't trust Hashem. That's it. There was no Torah yet. They didn't have to keep Shabbat, nothing, kosher, nothing whatsoever. All they had to do to be faithful and grateful and to say, God, you saved us from these cruel Egyptians. You released us from slavery. You interfere with the law of nature for us. You want us to follow you to the desert? Yes, sir. No question asked. It's obvious. Why? It's obvious. No, no. They say, okay, we really appreciate. Thank you very much. You did, like they say in Israel, the servant did his share. Now get out of here. You did what you had to do. Thank you very much. It doesn't work that way. So now we finally released. Beautiful days are starting in Egypt. Let us stay and get back our home and businesses and degrees and whatever. That's it. We're not in the mood now to travel in the desert out of nowhere. We don't want to go on a journey. Leave us here. We appreciate. We're not ungrateful. We will never forget what you did for us. We'll celebrate the holidays here. Give us the Torah in Cairo. In Alexandria. We don't want to receive the Torah in the middle of nowhere. That's all they wanted. Hashem said, oh yeah? No problem. Shh. Millions. Shh. Millions in the darkness. Plague. Kill them and bury them with the Egyptians together. Why? Only one problem. You don't trust me, I don't need you. Remember this sentence. You don't trust me, I don't need you. You trust me, I'll do everything for you. I know someone who trusted you and he just died. I know one like this. Full trust in Hashem yet. More than words can describe. He was 75 years old. People have to die eventually. But still, what a trust he had in Hashem. Couldn't give him another 20 years. The length of the life, it's not an indication of anything. The Ari lived 39 years old. Ramchal, 38. Many big tzaddikim lived less than 40 years old. Less than 40 years old. The Ramchal lived less than 40 years old, and he wrote books more than a rabbi that would live 800 years today. If the chief rabbi of the world would live 800 years today, still cannot get to the level of the Ramchal, who basically did everything he did in about 20, 25 years of his life, until he became Bar Mitzvah. That's it. Age 19, he already had the angels coming and giving him secrets. The Gaon Mivilna was 9 years old. He already knew what all the rabbis in the world combined don't know when he was 9 years old. Do you understand? I always say to people, if we only really understand who these rabbis that we read their books were, just by mentioning their name, we would faint. From respect, we would faint. You know? I have sometimes people, after they're listening to me for months or for years, finally they get to come. Like a couple came from Florida yesterday to Brooklyn. Ah, you should see the excitement. We finally get to see a human being to human being, almost fainting. If we saw now Rabbi Akiva comes in, get a heart attack from the excitement. Think about it. We hold their books, put it on the shelf, we're not fainting. The stipler, when he was learning Gemara, every time he finished, after a few hours of deep learning, He was holding the Gemara like this and running around the table and dancing and singing and jumping when he was alone. He thought at least he's alone. The students were peeking to see what he's doing. So if you wouldn't know what he just did, what would you say? Ah, there's a crazy old man out there. Come, come, see. He's dancing with a book in his hand. You know, an American, I think, Secretary of Defense or in a culture, somebody from the Congress, they took her to Israel. And you know, in Israel, Simchat Torah, it's already in the night. They go with cars and microphones. They make a big party with the Torah. Because over here, you have 2 days. Shmini Atzeret is 2 days. In Israel, second day, it's a weekday already. Everyone, in the end of Shmini Atzeret, they make a big party all over. Over here, it's Yom Tov, so you cannot use electric. But over there, already the end of Shmini, at the end of Simchat Torah, Shmini Atzeret, Simchat Torah, they make a big party on the streets. So this American woman from Congress, she saw so many people on the street dancing with the books in their hand. So she asked the host in a limo they drive, the limo that got stuck for Obama, you know, I need a top lock. You know, so she asked, what are they doing? Why are they so happy? What are they holding in their hands? So he said, this is our book of law, the Torah. So she said, but I never saw people dancing with the book of law. Everywhere I go, people hate the law. Why everyone is dancing with the book of law? So the answer is, ma'am, there's two kinds of book of laws. Book of law that stupid people like you and me wrote, and book of law that the creator of the world wrote. It's a difference. There's a little bit difference between this and this. People that wrote the laws, of course people hate it. But when God wrote the law, how can you hate it? Is God doing something that is not good? You know, one Hasid, he smuggled to Israel thousands of bottles of good whiskey. Thousands of bottles. And they caught him. They caught him in the airport. You know, he's supposed to go in a green light, in a red light to pay a duty. I went in a green light, and like me, whenever I go, sir, come here, they always call me, they see me with a suit. They think this guy probably bring diamonds, millions, they always call me. But after a minute, they realize I have nothing. Most of the time, they don't even make me open the suitcase, because I smile to the guy, and I give him the say. So you already see, they're already expert, they know if you're nervous or not. So already see, I'm smiling, I'm talking, how are you today? These people that have diamonds, they're starting to faint. So one guy said, well, what are you bringing? You're bringing more than $10,000 in cash? I said, no, I'm very careful with that. He said, okay, go. That doesn't even open. You can open. You already get the point. The person is smiling, talking. He doesn't have, I'm about to open his bag. How is he smiling? But this is the idea here. So she asked, what's going on here? They dancing with the book of law? The answer, yes. If you know Hashem gave the book of law, of course. How can you not dance? How can you not? The stripler was dancing when he finished learning. So I always say, if we only know how lucky we are to be Jews, every day we run in the street, you know how a person was informed that he won the lottery? Let's say he doesn't have a shirt. He was getting dressed. He put his pants on, no shirt. And now they call him, sir, we came to inform you, you won $300 million. Now let's say his wife is outside in the street. What, out of craziness, he runs in the street, no shirt, no nothing, one shoe on, one shoe in the house, screaming, everyone looks at him. Does he care what people care now? Look at Moshe the neighbor, he became crazy, he runs in the street without a shirt. Like in Hebrew, there's the say, צוחק, מי שצוחק אחרון. You know what it means or no?
Who laughs last?
Who cares who laughs in the middle of the combat? Bottom line, who smiles in the end when the ring goes on? Who won the fight? In between, he gives him a punch, he's down, he's up. Nobody will remember that. Only one thing people remember. Who in the end was smiling? Not who smiled after the first round or the third round. So yeah, you run without a shirt, they think you're crazy and they laugh at you when they find out tomorrow why you ran without the shirt. Believe me, they will stop smiling. I promise you, they'll stop smiling. They will be very, very good friends of yours, like the bank. You know what's good about the bank? The bank is exactly like your friends. If you want to compare your friends to someone, compare them to the bank. As long as you deposit, everyone smiles to you. The day you stop depositing, the faces become very serious. Your friends, as long as they can get something out of you, everyone is smiling and pretending. One day when there is no interest in you, let's say you're a dead cow, you cannot give milk anymore. See how quickly they disappear. Right or wrong? You're smiling. Believe me, I did not invent the hypocrisy in this world. So now we have a question. One Kohen died and he came back to life after 40 minutes. It's a very common thing. It's clinical death, out of body experience. When he comes back to life, is he still holy like a Kohen or no? Because, you know, Kohen cannot be near a dead body. It makes him impure.
40 minutes?
Let's see, he's about to enter Beit HaMikdash. Even 10 minutes, doesn't matter. He's dead, that's it. No pulse, no nothing. Clinical death. If a Kohen touch a dead body, or a dead body touch a Kohen, or he went into the cemetery, or he went under a tree, who comes out of the cemetery to the street, and he went under the tree, or he went with a plane above a cemetery, or there was a body inside the plane. They take bodies to Israel for burial. All kinds of things like this. Or he was in a big catering hall and someone got a heart attack and died. The entire place became impure. So other people, okay, we're all impure anyway. Because once in our life we pass over a body or a cemetery, at least once. That's enough. That's it. Stay impure for the rest of your life because we don't have a red cow today to purify our bodies. But for Kohen, in the time of Beit HaMikdash, it was critical. Without the ashes of the red cow, he cannot ever enter to Beit HaMikdash. He's impure for the rest of his life. The question is, what happened if he was very careful never to go next to bodies, but he himself got a heart attack, and they revive him, the Hatzala. And now he wants to go back to his shift in Beit HaMikdash. Wait, amigo. Not so fast. Move. Poco, poco. Relax. We have a question. We need to ask Rav Ovadia. Rav Ovadia, what should we do with Moshe Cohen? What's the problem? He's a good Cohen. No, he just died and came back to life. What can we do? Huh? Good question, no? There's a lot of questions. A lot of questions like this about clinical death. How do we know, where does it say in the Torah there will be the resurrection of the dead? One time in history it happened with Ezekiel, we know. Where does it say in the Torah that one day the dead people, the deceased people, will rise from the grave and come back to life? Who knows? Where does it say in the Torah? It says in the Torah, the Gemara in Masechet Sanhedrin, page 90. Sanhedrin. The Gemara says, "Minayin letchiyat hametim min haTorah." Where do we see a hint, a proof in the Torah that all the dead people would resurrect? The Gemara says, there's a verse in the Torah, "Shene'emar." That's what the Torah says. "Venatatem mimeno et trumat Hashem le'Aaron haKohen." And you will give the truma. We take from the wheat, truma, and we have to give it to the Kohen. And Aaron, or you're going to give it to Aaron haKohen. So the Gemara says, what? Aaron would live forever? Aaron died in the desert. He never entered Israel. The temple is only in Israel. To give truma, it's only in Israel, not out of Israel. Here in America, it's a different story. In Israel, it's mitzvah from the Torah, when the Beit HaMikdash there. So the Gemara says, what? Aaron died. How are we going to give him truma in Beit HaMikdash? Right? Torah, it's a divine language. It's not Bialik. Bialik was religious until a certain age. So it says, שעתיד לחיות, וישראל נותנים לו תרומה. Obviously, he's coming back to life, and the Jews will give him תרומה. So from here we learn the answer to the question that I ask you. If Aaron would rise back to life, and then we're going to give him תרומה, that means he doesn't become impure by dying himself, only from another body.
See, have a paraduma already.
Huh?
They have a paraduma.
Ah, that's a good point. You have a kushiyah in the Gemara.
Why?
Because the Gemara didn't say it.
No,
the Gemara say, mikan, he say, you know, actually the kushiyah is Rav Zilberstein. Rav Zilberstein say, it's not me, it's one of the Gdolei Ador. He said, from here we have a proof. Actually, it's not him. It's Rav Chaim Berlin. That's his proof. Rav Chaim Berlin is a big yeshiva in Brooklyn. Rav Chaim Berlin. So it's his answer. What does it say? He said, from here we see that we're going to give Aaron. But the rabbi have a very good point. I said, that's not a proof that the Kohen did not lose his purity. Because by then, we will have a red cow. Because we have in tradition, we already had 9 red cows. 9 red cows. And we will have one more. That's it. Final. One more red cow. Plus, some people hold that there is a family of families that are passing the red cow ashes from father to son somewhere. Hiddenly. Nobody wants to, you know, it's like the people who win the lottery, they want to stay anonymous. They don't have one to come and beg them, give me, help me, give me. They don't want people to know. Once you become public, that's it, you have no life. I one time went to a wedding with one very wealthy Jew. He says he's worth more than $10 billion. So he was sitting, I was sitting here and he was sitting at a table next to me. That day, I realized that it's not such a good thing to be a very wealthy Jew. Maybe 30 people were standing online to talk to him in the middle of a wedding. This one, that widow, rabbi, everyone with his problems for donating in the middle of a wedding. He wants to come, eat. There's a line of people. Everywhere I go, people chasing him. In the parking lot, waiting outside, waiting by his office, waiting by his residence, knocking on his door. It's not like the Goyim. They surround their house with a big wall and 2 guys with a machine gun standing over there. We'll see you trying to ring the bell. Orthodox Jew doesn't do this. A person has a problem, they knock on the door. Even 1 o'clock at night. You know, Rav Steinman, he's 100 years old. Think about it. 100 years old. He lives in Bnei Brak. He's the leader of the Ashkenazi world today. So one father and his son came and knocked on his door 1 o'clock at night. 1 o'clock at night. Boom, boom, boom. So the rabbanit, his wife, she opens the door. She said, oh, what happened? He said, it's an emergency. It's an emergency. She said, let me see. I have to wake up the Rav. So she came to his room, said, some father and son, they say it's an emergency. I said, okay, let him in. So they go in, he has a little chair there, you should see how he sits in the bed from 60 years ago. So they go in, after 5 minutes, they both come out smiling. So it's a true story. The rabbi comes to him and says, Baron, what happened? They came in Panim Tisha B'Av, they went out Panim Purim. They came here, their face was Tisha B'Av. When they went out, their face was like in Purim. So quick, you're making magics here? So he said, the old man, he wants to run to politics. He wants to get a mayor or a council, something like that. So he came to ask me if he should do it or not. Tomorrow it's the last day, he has to pay the fee and get registered. So I told him, don't go. No one will vote for you besides your son. So she said, so why in this case he came out so happy? Should have come very sad. The rabbi told him, you told the loser, nobody will vote for you. So why is coming so happy? So he told her, because he was sure that even his son would not vote for him. And I told him, your son will vote for you. For that, he was happy. True story, that. That's called Banim Gidalti Veromamti Vem Pashubi. That's the word of the prophet in the name of Hashem. I raised my children. I made them the most important in the world. He's talking about us. And they betrayed me. Ashubi. Where does it say? It says, "Oti azvu mekor mayim chayim." They left me when I am the source of all the water, like an ocean. לחצוב להם בורות נשברים, and they went to dig holes, little holes in the ground. Maybe a drop of water would come out with some dirt. They replaced me, the big, pure, clean ocean, with a hole in the ground. Maybe a little water comes out. Do you know what it means, no? They left me and they went to the Kabbalah Center, or the church, or the Jehovah, what's the name? Jehovah Witnesses? Or Hare Krishna? Or the Indians that have the rats go all over the face? You know, in India, when you go to their big temples, it's very, very impressive. They spend so many millions of dollars over there just from their statues full of gold, this, and he has this angry face. Very scary. So they made the entrance very low. So automatically, when you want to enter one of these temples to see, you have to automatically bow down to their idol. That's how they trick you. So before you even say hello, you already bow down to our God. But they didn't know there is a nation called Israel. And the Israelis are wise guys. So the Israelis, even as secular as they are, they would not bow down to an idol. Make a survey. Take an American person, say, listen, the Indian, Maharaja, is asking if you don't mind to bow down to his Buddha. So Mr. Smith said, no problem. If he makes him happy, he goes like this and he comes in. Take an Israeli secular guy, earring over ear, tattoos, earring in his nose, ponytail, comes inside, they tell him, Itzik, come bow down to this idol. Say, get out of here. Itzik, no, 1 second. No. They won't agree. So what the Israelis do? They go in reverse. Baruch Hashem. Baruch Hashem שהבדילנו מן העמים. So Rabbi, it's a very good question. A very good point. We have to think about it. Rabbi said, just because Aaron would be able to serve in a temple when he arrives to life, it's not an indication that he rises automatically pure. Maybe he rises impure. And then after they use the red cow ashes, which will be used in the third temple, that's they will when they purify all the people. So we'll go together to the Yeshiva of Rav Chaim Berlin in Brooklyn if you want.
Says 3 days.
Huh?
Says 3 days. If somebody has to divorce his wife, if he died,
yeah,
he came back, is his wife still his wife?
Yeah, 3 days. What happened if he died and she married right away someone after?
He came back before 3 days?
Yeah.
So probably it's not good.
No, time ran out. But one more thing we have to talk about. A person died and he came back to life. Does he inherit his father? Why not? Who knows first? Let's understand what's the question here. Person died, and he came back to life. Why there is a question? Let me tell you a story. In the book of Jeremiah, chapter 32, the prophet Yirmiyahu, this is what he says. Hanamel ben Shalom say to Yirmiyah. There's a person named Hanamel ben Shalom. He said to Yirmiyah, he was his cousin. He said, "Ki lecha mishpat ha-yerusha ve-lecha geula liknot." This is a verse. He says, you have priority. If you want, you have the first right. You don't want, then we go to other people. But you are a relative. Therefore, according to the Torah, you are the first one we have to ask. So it says in Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer HaGadol was one of the biggest Tanaim in the Talmud. chapter 33, it says like this: the nation of Israel all went to do kindness, to do chesed with Shalom ben Tikva. And they saw a big army of soldiers, a group of soldiers coming to fight. They threw him into the grave of Elisha. They didn't know where to hide him. They're coming to kill him. So what are we going to do? The grave of Elisha was there. Elisha, the prophet. Right? Elisha in the time of Eliyahu Hanavi. And the man touched the bones of Elisha and came back to life. He was dead. They came to grab his body. You know, body has a value. You can blackmail. The Israeli paid the Hamas hundreds of 120 Arab murderers got released for body of 3 dead soldiers. So how much an Israeli dead soldier worth? 40 Palestinian lives. That's what happened now. And then Gilad Shalit, one Jew, 1,000 Arab murderers got released for one Israeli soldiers. So, obviously, a dead body has a value. Everywhere it has a value. If one of these basketball stars would die, and someone will buy his body from his family, and some kind freeze it, and then after 50 years, he would want to sell it on eBay. Do you know how many millions he's going to get for it? One famous athlete or movie star. There's always crazy people. People buy a lot on the moon, you know. I got an email like this. Are you interested to buy 1 acre on the moon? $10,000. Very cheap. You know, 1 acre on the moon? 1 acre. There's something even funnier than that. They sell stars. You want a star to be called after your name officially. So they call it Itzik Turgeman. That's the star. Moshe Itzhakov. David Gavrielo. That's how people pay money. It's not a joke. When I was a kid, I went to a store next to my house and I saw this goyim, Christian goyim, you know, they come to Israel. So they stand in a Judaica store and they buy little boxes, look like sardine boxes with the Israeli flag on it. I was a little kid, so I asked the owner of the store, what are they buying, these people? American goyim. So he said they buy air from the Holy Land. I'm serious. Inside, they take the box with them. They buy her. So I have a friend, I told you about him. He has more than 20,000 books. That's my library. Every book I need, I tell him, bring me this and this. Baruch Hashem. Hashem sent me a library 2 blocks away from my home. Beautiful. So one of his books, he come and say, listen, this, usually you return me the books in good condition. The last book you were very brutal with. I said, no, it wasn't really me. I didn't have room in my bag, so I sent it with a suitcase. I was in Istanbul. So he came from, you know, I took it with me. I learned on a plane, so I needed a good book. So on the way back, I had so many things. I brought tefillin from Israel. I don't send the tefillin in a suitcase. I have to put all the tefillin, mezuzot. And I have a little bag that they let you take on a plane. So what's more important, to put tefillin in mezuzot or this book? Well, it's kind of story. Something happened in the book. I pay you $20, finished. Tefillin is hundreds of dollars each. So I said, no problem. It's good. Somebody at least thinks that I'm learning. He's making jokes. At least all my library, all the books look used. Someone at least learns. So people come, I'm embarrassed. They see so many books, all of them brand new. You open them, you hear the first guy open. And some dust story. At least it's used. So then the next week, after the Yom Tov, he said, listen, you made my Yom Tov. So what happened? So, you know, I told him, you know, I was reading from this book. I said, this book was in Istanbul. The book was in Turkey. People are impressed. The book was in Turkey. So this guy was buying air from Israel. The question is, how this Jew was able to be so clever to think to make boxes with air from Israel that he will have customers for that. He should win the Nobel Prize winner for business. How he convinced thousands of people to order boxes with air inside. They paid up dollars for that.
It's lighter than earth.
Huh?
It's lighter than if you would sell
it. Lighter. There's a question. If your grandfather was a very, very big chacham, very big rabbi, and he left you a very, very old, dusty, ripped shoes. So you have the shoes of your grandfather, which was a very holy man. So you watch them like this is the most precious thing for you. And then the cleaning lady, she came, she saw ripped shoes like this, put it in the garbage. And now you're suing her for shoes that technically don't even worth a dollar. If you put them in the street, in a boot, somebody comes, sees shoes like these, dusty, dirty, old, ripped, you won't even pay a dollar for it. $5 the most. So you want her to pay you $1 million because it's sentimental. Like it's the shoes of the Gaon Mivilna, the shoes of the Ramchal, the shoes of Moshe Rabbeinu. It's worth millions. Imagine if they find the shoes of Moshe. You know how much they will sell it in Sotheby's? One page from the Rambam, Maimonides, from 900 years ago, with holes. The handwriting of the Rambam, more than 20 years ago, was sold for $1 million. One page of writing of the Rambam, handwriting of the Rambam, with holes, many holes in the page. You only can see a few words. $1 million in Sotheby's. So imagine the shoes of Moshe Rabbeinu. The shoes of Rav Shach, when he passed away 107 years old, when he was a teenager, which means about 90 years earlier, Rav Iser Zalman Meltzer, the grandfather of the Rav Kotler from Lakewood, he bought the shoes to the boy Eliezer after he walked 1 week in the time of the war. He walked 1 week from his home. He didn't have money for the train. With a huge bag on his back, he walked for 1 week to get to Yeshiva when the planes were bombing all over. When the rabbi released all the kids to go to their parents because he didn't want to be responsible for their life. So his wife told him, what kind of rabbi is this? He sends you back home in a time of a war. Don't he know that the Torah is the only thing that can save you in times like that? Go back to the yeshiva and see it. Whatever happened, it's from Hashem. So after a week, when he arrived back, because he didn't have money again for the train, he had to walk for 1 week with a big bag on his back. And he was very skinny, poor boy. His bar mitzvah was, his mother sent him tefillin to the yeshiva, that's it. Not even one cookie. That's how poor they were. For 2.5 years he was sleeping on the floor in a horrible winter of Europe. There was no mattresses. Not like today. 13 bedrooms in a house, 2 kids and 2 dogs. And the kids are fighting where they're going to sleep tonight. They're debating, should I sleep in this room, that room? Every kid has 3 bedrooms. Over here he designed it purple, over here pink. There was a different time. So he felt so bad that he had to walk all the way back. So he gave him, I think, 300 rubles for these shoes. And he gave it to his son, or son-in-law of Kotler, who gave it to his son. And today it's in a wall unit of Rav Malkiel Kotler, Rosh Yeshivat Lekud. Rav Steinman went to his house for Shabbat. He see the shoes inside the wall unit, next to the silverware there. So, well, why you put dirty shoes like this inside next to the silver candles, you know? So, oh, this shoes is legend. That's a sign of a kosher Jew that gives his life for the Torah. It's worth trillions. There's no value for that. So now imagine the cleaning lady didn't know, or somebody, I don't know, construction, he took it and threw it out. Now you're suing him in court. Does he have to pay you $1 for the value of the shoe, or he has to pay you $1 million for the real value of it? Huh? $1. How sad. Because the Torah punish you for what you responsible for. If you did, you had no way to know it's worth, if you knew that it's worth fortune, that's a different story. But you just see a ripped shoe, and every normal person put it in the garbage. That's a different story. So there's no sentimental values in court. That's why when you have something sentimental, you have to be extra careful. Either put sign, safe, lock it, make sure that people understand it's just not $1 shoes from the market. So what's the story? They threw him to the grave of Elisha, the prophet, and he came back to life. And after that, he gave birth. After he came back to life, he gave birth. So what we see, that even though his the father died and came back to life, he still considered his son. It's very interesting, you know, there's one person in India that died for 2 days. 2 days was dead. In the middle of his funeral, he was banging on the box, on the wood box. 2 days. There's one person in Israel, Avi Hajani, 43 minutes was dead. They already covered him and he was on the way to the refrigerator. 43 minutes later, he came back to life. When according to science, 6 minutes, that's it, you brain damage permanently. 43 minutes, he's giving lectures in Israel today. 43 minutes. The only person, to the best of my knowledge, in the world who died twice clinical death. And had the trial twice. And twice, I don't know why, Hashem sent him back here and didn't take him for good. Twice. First time he tried to be religious, 3 months, and he went back to be a criminal. Second time he died, he got the point. Should we count on 2 miracles like this to happen to us? What's the chance? We want to be ready when the time comes. We want to be ready. What do you mean? It doesn't matter when you die. It's important, of course. It's where you go when you die. Remember, that's what's important. Yes, 60, 70, 90. Life is a blink of the eye anyway. If a person go on a road test to be a driver, and the test took, instead of 5 minutes, 4 minutes and 52 seconds. Anybody cares? No. If it took 4 minutes, it's 20% shorter. 4 minutes or 5 minutes? Anyone care? And if it took 2 minutes, less than half. 2 minutes, it's like dying when you're 17. 2 minutes instead of 5 minutes. Three-fifths of your life is gone, 60%. So if a person lives about 70, 80 years, somebody like that, he dies in his 20s. It's a tragedy, horrible. So if a person like this died, he care if the test was 2 minutes or 5 minutes? Nobody cares. It's only one thing we have to care about. In what status this person died? Tzaddik or Rasha? That's it. The rest is not so important. Everyone emphasized, young, old, poor, he didn't get married, he didn't have a life yet, he's a soldier, he gave his life for the land. Nobody puts their finger on the right thing. Who cares? That's all nonsense. There's only one thing count. He goes to heaven or to hell. And for how long? That's not important. What do you think? When he goes to heaven next to Moshe Rabbeinu, he's going to miss his life here? Getting up in the morning like sardine in a subway, people sweating, cigarette breath in his face, pushing, fighting, his boss torturing him, going home. His wife making him faces, his children eat his heart, bankruptcy, problem, cholesterol, doctors, traffic, headache. He's going to miss this life? No, so he has a beautiful mansion. What's better, a mansion on the beach or heaven?
Heaven.
Heaven. You know a person that murdered a 13-year-old boy or a girl? And he murdered a person 120 years old. What's the difference between the punishment of both murderers? Same exact punishment. What is it? Execution by the Jewish court. So the murderer that killed the old man, 120 years old, can't even open his eyes. They ask him, Yitzhak, what's your name? I don't know. Who is Yitzhak? Alzheimer, he doesn't remember his name. He's 120 years old. Everyone knows he has a day or two to live. How long is he going to live? He cannot even walk. He killed him in bed, like they do in a hospital here every minute. So they killed him there, and somebody who killed a young, live boy, healthy, running, playing, same punishment, how can it be? So the murderer who killed his old man, he comes and screams in court, where is the justice? You're comparing my crime to his crime. He deserves execution. He took a healthy young boy or girl, whatever. But why? Why are you punishing me? I did him a favor. You have to give me an award. No? So why really it's the same punishment? Who can give me the answer? No, that's the last thing for tonight. Hi, Emil, what do you say? How can it be? God is very logical. Why it's the same punishment? Very good. Because a life of a human being, 1 minute here, 1 minute, it's already no value that you can evaluate it in money or in any way. You know how much a person can achieve in 1 minute? All it takes to get saved from hundreds of years of hell, and right away to go to hundreds of thousands of billions of trillions of years in heaven, it's one sentence. It's the last sentence before you died. One sentence. Let's say you have $100 million all your life, no Hashem, no Shabbat, no nothing. Second before he died, he say, Rabbi, all my money, all my houses, everything I have, take and use to save souls. Keep your yeshiva running. Make sure thousands of people learn Torah. It's all for the yeshiva and for saving souls. That's it. And died. How long did it take to say this sentence? 10 seconds. That's it. Right now, hundreds of years of suffering, that Auschwitz is a picnic compared to this, turned into the most beautiful heaven right away. That's what the Gemara says, Yesh Adam Koner Olamo Berega Echad. But if you count to say it one sentence before you died, after 120 years old, I promise you, you won't be able to say it. Why? How do I know? Because the Torah say, someone who tried to trick Hashem, Hashem will trick him. What does it mean? Haomer, Echta, Veashuv. Echta ve'ashuv, en maspikim be'ado. Someone who says, now I'm going to make sins. I know the truth. I mean, how many lectures I heard? I know. I get emails like this every day. You already convinced me. There's no question if yes, no, it's divine. I'm not ready for it. I don't know where people invented this stupid sentence. I'm not ready for it. To win the lottery tomorrow, you ready? Or you want to get it in 30 years, little by little? You're very ready, no? From being a cleaning lady to become a princess of the world. Very ready. Yesterday didn't have money for shoes. Today, oh, all of a sudden you give orders to the servants. How come people adjust so quick? Of course they're ready. It's all excuses. So what's going on here? What's going on here? Someone who knows the truth and say, one day I will be tzaddik. One day I'll make tshuva. I'll use the money, I'll work on Shabbat, I'll cheat a little bit here and there, I'll do all these things. But what's the point? Anyway, in the end, now I'm going to donate everything to the yeshiva. That's my will here. Go to the lawyer, check. I'm not lying. The lawyer has a will. Hashem won't let you do it. Why? You know now, you don't play games. That's called en maspikim be'ado. Not only you're not going to be able to do it, if you finally will be serious about your promise, Hashem will make sure you won't be able to do it. Heart attack. Someone will steal your money a year before. Your accountant wired all the money to his account. When you came to your bank account, you found that it's empty. Your drug addict son took all the money before you realized because he knew you in a hospital. Your ex-wife, after 15 wives you had, she somehow remembered your password and cleaned your account. Uncle Sam took his share. Obama needs a new limo. It won't work. You want to fool people? No. You want to fool Hashem? You fool yourself. Thank you very much. We'll see you next week.